Alright guys, so the first tip of this video is, if you're gonna jump off the map, at least do it right.
He tried.
Good morning, afternoon, and evening to all you wonderful people across the world. So, my last tip video had a very good reception, so I decided I'd make a new video with footage I've compiled over time. This video will highlight tips for playing the survivors, and specifically the infected I'm showing on screen. I wasn't able to get footage for the hunter and spitter, so with that being said, buckle up, enjoy the ride, and get ready to learn. So for tip number one, I'm going to go over something called speed laddering. I'm going to teach you all how to do it and the importance of why you should make a habit out of doing it. So the first step of speed laddering is determining what direction you will face while you climb. For me personally, I have made it a habit of facing to my left while I do this. No matter what though, you have to aim directly up or down when you do this. I prefer to aim up because I like to see where I'm going as opposed to where I just came from. So that right there is what I'm looking for. Once my weapon disappears, I know that I'm stuck to the ladder. Now that I'm stuck, I can start pressing my keys in tandem with keeping my reticle aimed where it needs to be. Now, while I'm making my way up the ladder, I'm also pressing the W and D key. I press the D key because it's what I use to normally move to the right, and you need to be pressing that because I'm facing to the left. Now, if you want to practice this, I recommend you do so on map 5 of the parish, where there's a ladder inside of the safe room that is easily accessed. While speed laddering can be done for zombie ladders as well, the new zombie ladders they added in the Last Stand update are not as reliable and can cause you to slip and fall. So keeping that in mind, you're actually sometimes better off using the standard method. Key takeaway is to practice speed laddering as both infected and the survivors. I promise it will help you both surprise and evade the enemy team. So this next tip I have is called the smoker double tap. It's mostly meant for use with the tier 1 shotgun, however, the fundamentals of why it works can be applied to any weapon, and you'll see why in a second. So the whole point of this strategy is to soften up the smoker as he's about to pull you in with a body shot because the body's much easier to hit, and right before you get tangled, boom, you pop him right in the face. Try to aim for the head and finish him off. Now, finally, to reiterate, he can only pull from a straight line from you to him, so start out by shooting from the body and work your reticle up to his head before you get tangled. This next tip I have for you all is called pre-firing. What you do is you try to anticipate where the enemy team is going to attack from and fire in that specific area. Now, the more verses you play, the more you begin to notice where people are likely to attack, so a lot of it does come down to developing game sense. And if you sense an attack may be coming from right around the corner, then fire away once you start drawing near. Just make sure you have your team nearby to cover you if you expend all the ammo in your clip.
Oh, nice.
So if anyone ever doubts the effectiveness of speed laddering here, watch how it saves me in this situation. Unfortunately, it wasn't enough to save that guy. So right here, I'm doing what's called a ladder block. The tank is literally unable to get up the ladder because I'm there and he can't get through me. So in an act of desperation, he tries to throw a rock at me, and all you have to do here is just dodge it and then come back to the ladder. As you can see, this is a great way to limit the tank's options and deny his mobility, all while shooting him in the process. So as the tank's coming in here, I can tell his aggression is faced towards me, so watch what I do next. So as you can see, as he started to get close to me, I made a super tight turn around that tree and used the terrain to my advantage. As long as I can keep him at a distance like that, I can just continue to shoot him and he won't be able to even touch me. So once he whiffs one of his punches, I know I can go in for a free melee hit, and I do exactly that here. Since I was facing him while I swung my crowbar, I know that he's probably going to come after me, so I instantly back off and create distance. Once you sense that the tank's really low health, I just go in and start swinging. If you're gonna get up close with a tank like this though, make sure you're always trying to hit him on his flanks or behind him, and just remember that he has roughly a 2 second cooldown after every punch. Key takeaway is to use terrain to your advantage and don't be afraid to get a few swings in on the tank, especially if he's distracted or if he's really low health. So one of the best tools the tank has available to himself is the car. As you can see, he's trying to smack it towards us, but it actually ends up falling into this little area over here. Watch what happens. So right here, I know where the car is, but I don't know where the tank is, so I'm just looking to see what his next course of action is. Once I see he's going for the car, I know he's going to be in an enclosed area, so I try to ricochet the Molotov so that it lands right where the car is. And there you have it, folks. We have a lit tank. I used my brain. Do I get a gold star now? Can I get a gold star? Okay, thank you. So this clip is yet another example of using your predictive power to light the tank on fire. You always want to prepare for the worst case scenario from the enemy team. 99% of the time, I don't know the skill level of the tank I'm going up against, so it's always important to respect the skill level of your opponents. In this specific case, I am predicting that the tank will try to climb the zombie ladder so that he can play the rock tank. I'm the only one with a Molotov, so I need to make it count, or else he'll drag out the game to maximize their damage on us over time, which is honestly what he should be doing. So as you can see, the second I see the tank jump to commit, I start throwing my molly. Just make sure you're compensating for the drop-off so that the molly actually goes where you want it to. As you can see, even though he was slightly above the flames, he still got lit on fire. Him trying to play rock tank was his plan all along, but now I put him on a timer and he has to commit. So this clip is a great example of why you should aim much higher than you think you should when you're throwing the molly long distance. Just look at how much I have to compensate to get the molly where I need it to go.
On fire. Whoa.
Nice. So in this clip, we have a fairly competent enemy tank playing rock tank, and his goal is to just try and maintain free vision and chip us down with rocks. Right now, a lot of us are only equipped with tier 1 weapons, so we're not actually able to do a lot of damage to him. I really want this tank to come down and play right now, so I'm trying to think of a way to molly him. I take my shot here because I don't want to be slow. That makes me an easy target, and when I'm speedy after taking adrenaline, it makes it easier to dodge his rocks. So after a certain point, you have to say enough is enough, and I've also begun to notice that he keeps rocking from the same exact spot, so watch what happens. As the saying goes, the best predictor of future behavior is past behavior. I predicted he would stay in that spot, and now he's cooking. So in this section, I'm going to be going over the importance of creating chaos as the jockey, as opposed to attacking directly. This can also be done with the hunter, who's more effective indoors where there are many walls to bounce off of. The tank is also going in without any support whatsoever. Don't do this. Always wait for your team. As the tank, you should be making an assessment based on the area you're in, whether or not you should play rock tank. But anyway, back to the jockey. Watch what happens. So right here as the jockey, my job is to keep the guns away from our tank as much as possible because he's the best shot we have at incapping all the survivors. So right now I'm like, hey, look at me. Keep your guns pointed towards me where I can dodge your bullets easily because the tank is basically a bullet sponge, but the jockey isn't. So basically the more annoying and evasive you are, the better. You may have noticed that once I do get their attention and I see that they're shooting at me, I just run away, find cover, and then just jump right back in. Also, quick side note, never ever throw a rock when you're this exposed as the tank. Ever. Again, my goal as the jockey here is to distract and prolong this fight as long as I can so we can maximize our damage on the other team, and also to support my tank in whatever way that I can. So as you can see here, Coach is in a pretty vulnerable position here trying to pick up Nick, so I make it my job to delay him as much as possible. So as you can see, I'm kind of perched at the top of this ladder, ready to spawn from behind the bus, but I also want to make sure my team is ready. As you can see them off in the distance there, they're not quite ready yet, and therefore I'm not going in yet. Again, the jockey can work fantastically as an initiator. However, he doesn't need to be the tip of the spear in any given initiation. Now, because of the fact that you can't always keep tabs on where your teammates are attacking from, you just have to trust them and know that they're spawned in, judging by the red circle around their icon here. After you initiate, you just have to trust your teammates and hope that they grab who they want to grab, and then just go in and commit. So I'm just going to do a little play-by-play right here to summarize what I'm trying to say. So I'm not even trying to directly attack, I'm more just trying to get their eyeballs on me and then hide and duck away to distract so I can enable my teammates. Again, this is exactly what I'm looking for because I see that their red circle kind of went away for a second. I know that they're committing, I know that they're attacking without even having to look at them. Another important thing to take advantage of is the trees, especially on the Left 4 Dead 1 maps. It's really useful to take advantage of them to keep the survivors guessing as to where you are. You can't really hear it in the video, but I'm also paying attention to the sound cues of my teammates as well. I hear that one of the survivors gets grabbed, so I know that's my cue to go in and commit to my part of the attack. So I was already able to grab Francis at the top of the ladder here on death toll. It looks like my other teammates have kept the other survivors busy, so I'm just trying to pull him as far away as possible. So, some of you may know that scratching an incapped survivor while they're getting up will interrupt the process, but what I see a lot of people not doing is waiting until the last possible second to do so, so watch what happens. So, every second counts when it comes to wasting the survivor's time, especially when someone's incapped, because it'll allow more of your teammates to spawn in, and you can create this perpetual cycle of going in and going in and going in and keeping them down over and over. Whenever I get an opportunity to escape though, I do so, because if I can stay alive, I can keep harassing them. So we kept up the pressure so much here that Francis actually died from all the commons on him, and me using all of my little evasive tricks like jumping and hopping and using the zombie ladder, speed laddering, it all leads to a very difficult challenge for the other team to deal with. So right here I see this guy on top of the broken bridge. I notice that his teammates have kind of left him up there without cover, so I see him as an easy target and therefore I go after him. So sensing that he's in danger, he decides to back up and he tries to reconvene with his teammates before he gets grabbed, which I almost did here. Another important tip is to use line of sight blockers to your advantage as the jockey, because as special infected you have the inherent advantage of knowing exactly where all the survivors are at any given moment, unless they're ghosting. So even though good players will know your general location, if they still can't see you, they can't know exactly where you are. So I was able to grab Zoe here, and right now I'm just making sure that she stays out of line of sight of the other survivors so that I can continue to damage her without any disturbance. And what our smoker is doing right here is exactly what he should be doing. He knows that his tongue is on cooldown, so he decides to help me out and scratch Zoe and stack on some additional damage, which definitely earns him a gold star. So in this footage, I just wanted to reiterate the importance of damage stacking. And damage stacking is basically when a survivor's grabbed and you're basically just scratching them to stack on more damage. As you can see, after every time I scratch, I check to see where the survivors are and how close they are to us. So in Left 4 Dead 2, the charger does 10 damage per punch and the hunter does 6 damage per scratch. So these would be the two best special infected to damage stack with. But really, you can do it with anyone. The best opportunity to damage stack is when you're able to catch a survivor alone or otherwise separated from their team. Oh, and one last thing. So if you're damage stacking and you manage to incap the survivors, there's no reason to keep doing it unless you're confident that you can kill them before the survivors come back. Alright, so for this next tip, I'm going to show you the importance of smoking from cover. It's good to think of the smoker as more of a sniper. He's definitely not a frontliner like, say, the charger, and I would say he's more of a support character that helps to enable your jockeys, your chargers, and your hunters. So right here, we're on map 2 of Death Toll, and I know a lot of people like to cut to the left or right in order to get into a better position for the initial attack. Watch what happens. So as I grab Bill here from behind cover, you can see how the survivors are having a hard time even shooting the tongue as I'm pulling him in. The smoker is truly a stellar initiator because of his ability to grab the survivors from a distance without too many issues. Even if my teammates had failed here, the survivors would still have trouble killing me because of where I'm hiding. To wrap up this tip, I just want to say that while having a high ground advantage of the smoker is usually a good idea, it can become very predictable to the survivors, so I recommend simply just using your best judgment. What really matters is being spawned around objects and corners where you're ready to pull the easy targets into positions that are advantageous to your fellow infected. Key takeaways: if you're a smoker, you're a sniper, so just pretend you're playing Call of Duty or something. Also, what the boomer just did here, yes, 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 always do that. Good job, boomer. Gold star for you. So you might be thinking right now, well, he's got the charger and it says initiation as the smoker, so what the hell's going on here? Well, you can't hear it right now, but actually I'm coordinating with the smoker on our team to essentially attack first so that I can cover him. Let's see what happens. So I see our smoker off in the distance trying to get a spawn in a good position. I know that he's very likely going to pull the one in the back because of where he's positioned. So as you can see, right when our smoker spawns, I spawn. This is just one of those fundamentals of initiating as infected that you have to learn. So as you can see, Dumb and Dumber over here have taken notice to the smoker pulling Rochelle. As a result, I get a good idea of where exactly they're gonna move, so I charge in the opposite direction. Watch what happens. As you can see, with me just saying, "Hey smoker, can you pull in the back and I'll cover you?" we were able to inflict this much damage on the survivors. Nick's getting bot hunted, Rochelle is getting pulled, Ellis is getting pounded, Coach doesn't know what the fuck is going on. It truly speaks for itself. So key takeaways are, if no one else is shot calling for your team, try your best to coordinate with your fellow smoker and have him pull from behind. If he ignores you, then fuck him. Leave the game and find someone else who deserves you, King. So to give this clip some context, we're on map 3 No Mercy in the sewers. So our tank just smacked Francis down in the corner over there, and he's now hiding in the tunnel above. As you'll see in a second, his teammates don't even want to come close in fear of an ambush. So knowing that Francis can't defend himself, I opt to vomit on him to increase the pressure even more on the other team to respond before he dies. So my tentative plan right here was to go through this tunnel and then drop in behind them. but after seeing my teammates scatter charge, I quickly turn around and make my way over to him, and you'll see why in a second. So as you can see here, this tip is all about hugs. Whenever you have a boomer and a charger and you can't puke, waddle over to him and give him a big old hug. And if the survivors end up popping you, you'll stumble him, reset his cooldown, and enable him to lay waste to his next target. So not only can your explosion blind, stun, and stumble the survivors, but the commons will quickly come in to aid you in slowing down the survivors considerably. If you're the charger in this case, try to line up the survivors and watch them get knocked around like bowling pins. Key takeaways: don't just sit around after you puke as the boomer. Play an active role in enabling your teammates to inflict more damage with hugs. The boomer is very slow, but he can be extremely effective if you manage to escape after puking in multiple ways that I'll describe later. So this next clip is in the same exact vein as the last one, except it's from the charger's perspective. Watch what happens. So we're just going to go over this clip and break it down one more time, and then we can move on. Just as a quick side note though, I don't think it's enough for me to tell you guys, well, just coordinate with your team, when in reality, I feel like what a lot of people need to know is how to exploit the game's mechanics to coordinate properly against the survivors. If you practice these tips, I assure you it will yield results even when you mess up the first few times. All right, so all I'm doing right here is telling my boomer, all right, boomer, I'm gonna go in right here around this hedge. Make sure to hug me. So what he did here was actually super important. Not only did he hug me, but he also made an effort to come up on my right flank and get in the way of the bullets that were being fired at me. As you can see, he was able to free me from my hold on Rochelle by doing this, and without the patience of a very skilled player, this is often something you can exploit. So in other words, get between the slugs when you go to do your hugs. So this next tip is the rocket boom. It's a tried and true classic that everybody should know. If you have a boomer and the ability to get a high ground advantage somehow, you should at least consider doing this every time. Let's watch what happens. All right, so the first step in how you do this is to get up on some high ground and determine not where the survivors are, but where they're going to be. This is very important because the amount of value you get from your puke increases dramatically the more survivors you hit. So as you can see with how I'm moving on this roof, I'm not only compensating for their future position, but I'm also compensating for the momentum that I need to build up in order to accelerate myself properly as the boomer. All right, so we're just gonna go over this one more time to go over the mechanics of what's happening. So really all there is to it is just maintaining a given direction as a ghost. Right as you jump, click spawn. All of the momentum you gained as a ghost will carry over into your physical form. Oh, and also a super important side tip here. If you can get away with it, always try to escape as the boomer. If you manage to escape, you can despawn back into a ghost and cause even more chaos for the survivors. So here's just another clip of me rocket booming, but as you can see above, that is not the tip of this clip. Instead, I'm gonna give you all another tip I find useful. So let's say that hypothetically I don't get shot immediately after I unpause this. The patient decision for them would be to back off and shoot me, but instead they do shoot me. Anyway, the point I'm trying to make is regardless of what happens, as long as you sit on top of an in-cap survivor as the boomer, you put them in a no-win scenario that works for your benefit. So this boomer tip actually applies to the spitter as well, although you have to make sure that you're positioned directly above the survivors if you want to maximize the effectiveness of your death puddle. And another side tip for you lesser experienced players, scratching an in-cap survivor while they're being picked up will immediately reset their progress bar, so keep that in mind when you're on cooldown and you don't know what else to do with your spawn. This final tip I'm calling the boomer block, so let's watch it earn its namesake. So right here, I try and tag these two with my vomit, but I only get one of them. That's okay. Watch what happens.
Hey,
So as you can see, Francis and Zoe here are already trying to move on. However, the jockey grabbing Lewis here gives us a huge advantage because the doorway serves as a choke point that we can use to deny entry. So with that being said, if you know where the survivors want to go as the boomer, get in the way. There's a myriad of situations that could warrant why the survivors would want to go in a specific direction, like running from a tank, escaping spitter goo, or in this case, trying to save a teammate. So key takeaways, if you're right in their path as the boomer, you're exactly where you need to be. And that's it, folks. This video took a very long time to make, but I just want to say that I'm super thankful for every single one of my subscribers. For a while, I was getting only 60 views per video, and it was a bit of a struggle, but in the past couple weeks, my channel has received a meteoric rise in viewership, and I just want you all to know that I don't take that for granted one bit. So again, thank you for sticking with me, and look forward to any future videos. I don't plan on quitting Left 4 Dead anytime soon. Peace.